for the inconvenience. The respected principal, sir, the speaker, research expert, to the delegates and idea colleagues. I feel honored to brief about today's speaker. He did his master's in mathematics from the Bombay
Excuse
College.
me, madam, Divya madam. Still, it is not audible properly.
I think you can proceed further.
Is it audible now, ma'am?
No, madam. No, madam. It is not audible.
I'll stress this one.
Can you rectify once more, just within a 2 minutes?
Is it clear, ma'am, now?
No, madam. Okay, no issue, ma'am. I take this opportunity to deliver the interactive talk. No problem.
Sorry for the interruption.
Okay, Divya, madam. Thank you. Kindly mute your microphone. And I take this opportunity to give an introduction about Dr. V. Rohan Paishal. And he did his master's in pharmaceutics from the Bombay College of Pharmacy, Mumbai, under the guidance of Professor Mala Meenan Madan, where he worked on developing dry powder inhalation formulations of high-dose drugs for anti-tubercular treatment. And he then worked in the formulation and development department of Rubicon Research Private Limited as a research officer, where he was actually involved in the development of a polymeric gastro-retentive drug delivery systems based on a platform technology. He then did his PhD in pharmaceutics from the Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, under the guidance of Professor P.R. Vaivya sir, where he worked on the development of novel drug delivery systems for ophthalmic applications using computer-aided approaches. As a part of his research, dealt with applying computational methods to streamline the process of screening materials and systemically designing drug delivery systems. Currently, he's an assistant professor in the School of Pharmacy at SPKM NMIMS Shobhaben Patel School of Pharmacy and Technology Management. His research interest lies in exploring interdisciplinary knowledge from different areas of applied science and utilizing them in drug delivery applications. Privileged to have you on this platform, sir, and really privileged to see two words, especially in your bio read, that is, you give an honor to your guides, especially Mala Meenan ma'am and Vaivya sir. So it shows how humbled you are towards your guide. Thank you so much, really wonderful to have you on this platform. So with this short and detailed bio, I request you to take on the session. Thank you, sir.
Sir,
I
please
would
unmute yourself. Thank
first
you.
like to thank Seven Hills College of Pharmacy, the principal Sucharita ma'am, and all the other committee members who have given me this opportunity to speak at this training program alongside all the eminent speakers. I've gone through the list and their topics. They are quite some eminent speakers from the industry and academia. And I was also pleasantly surprised to see one of the names, Dr. Anil Gandhi, who will be, I think, speaking tomorrow. I was
Yes, sir.
associated with him in Rubicon. So I'm thankful to you to give me space to speak alongside him as well. So can I start?
Yes, sir. Continue.
Okay, thank you. Is this screen visible? Hello? Yes, ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir, it's perfectly visible,
Oh,
sir.
okay, thank you, thank you. Okay, so today I'm going to speak on the application of computational tools in screening and formulation development. Okay, so the whole talk has been based on some computational techniques that can be used for screening or developing formulations. Before proceeding, I would like to clarify that I'm not an expert in computational biology, but I do have experience in using some of these softwares that have been there for some other purpose. So I'm speaking out of these experiences. So my talk is going to be oriented upon three things. Firstly, application of some computational tools. I'm not going to go into the depth of what these computational tools are, because this is the fifth day of the training program. I'm sure some of the speakers must have already covered it. So I'll straight away start with the application part, but I will have a background to these computational techniques. I will discuss the scope for application of these in drug delivery, as well as the importance of knowing these computational techniques, perhaps for the students or the young researchers out there. Then I would be taking up two examples of different computational techniques, how it can be applied to perhaps one is screening and one in formulation development. And just as a note, all of these examples, they relate to nano drug delivery system. So I would like to start off with this image of all these stages of a drug product development. Those with a pharmaceutical background must be knowing this image and have seen it quite 100 times perhaps in different subjects like pharmacology, biopharmaceutics, chemistry, regulatory, clinical pharmacology, etc. But why I am showing you is to make you understand the importance of these computational techniques. All the points or the bullets that have been mentioned here, we should appreciate the fact that almost all of it can now be performed on a computer. If not yet in practice, but at least in research, all of them have been explored on a computer or using some computer softwares. Another important thing that this image showcases is the time that requires for this drug product development. It takes around 12 to 15 years. Computational techniques can greatly reduce this time by a fraction. It can even extend this time to 20 and more years. So computational techniques can help in even reducing this time. And another important aspect of having these knowledge of computational techniques while developing a drug product is that it reduces the chance of failure. Okay, by applying precision-based computational techniques, a computer, it is known to be very accurate, very precise. So by applying these techniques in drug product development, you can definitely reduce the chances of failure. And why is it important is because as you go down this timeline, the cost of failure increases tremendously. So it is quite okay to fail at an early stage like drug discovery than to fail at a clinical stage. And to fail post-marketing is even more disastrous. What I would be covering is a small fraction of this drug product development. Mainly related to drug delivery, or you can call it as formulation development. I would be covering a nano drug delivery system and an important aspect of it, that is screening, or you can call it pre-formulation. So in the previous slide, although I have referred to it as a very small or a fraction of the whole step, formulation development itself is a vast process and it starts with pre-formulation. So pre-formulation, we assess the physical properties, the chemical properties of the drug and how it would affect the stability. Why is it important? Is because all of these together will finally determine the pharmaceutical properties of the drug, which will finally translate into the formulation. So pre-formulation or the screening, you can say, is what lays down the foundation of transforming a new drug into a pharmaceutical formulation, which will eventually go into the further clinical studies. So there is a lot that can go wrong in this step. And to reduce that, we can use some computational techniques which can offer aid in screening or developing these formulations. So why I'm saying that computational tools can be used in pre-formulation or formulation development? The use of computational tools is nothing new. It has been used in drug discovery since quite some decades now, but it can also be used in pre-formulation or formulation development is because the physical properties, the chemical properties and the stability that I just described in the previous slide, all of it at the end, it comes down to molecular properties. If you see physical properties like solubility, it may be at times associated with pH, properties like pKa, stability which may be associated with the presence of a particular functional group and how it will interact at a particular pH or pKa, etc. It all comes down to molecular properties. And when it comes to molecular properties or the molecular scale, it is very well, it can be studied using computational tools. So this is why perhaps screening, pre-formulation, and some aspects of formulation development, especially nano drug delivery systems, can be well studied using some computational tools. So we keep talking about computational tools. You must have been hearing it since the last 5 days. Other eminent speakers must have also taken it up. So what are these computational tools? So just to give a brief about them in simplest of terms, we can have a real world system wherein you can equate it with a real world problem with respect to formulation, maybe dissolution of a drug, the pharmacokinetics of a drug. All this would be a real world system. You can derive mathematical models around it. You can describe it in terms of equations. You can describe it in terms of theories in numbers, which can also be interchangeably sometimes referred to as the computer model. You can use these computer models, which are imitation of these real world systems. And you can use these computer models to simulate using some techniques that are available to us in the form of a software. So you can finally simulate these real world systems, the real world problems on a computer using some techniques that are available to us, like molecular dynamics, quantum mechanics, coarse grain simulation, continuum simulation, etc. So in simplest of terms, I would define computational tools as some techniques which are available to us in the form of software packages to simulate a real world problem on a computer, and hence the term in silico. I'm sure by now everyone must be aware of this term in silico. In vitro is doing something on, say, a petri dish. In vivo would be inside a living organism. And in silico is doing all that, that is simulating all of it on a computer. But just knowing these computational tools or techniques is not enough. It is also important to know where to apply which kind of techniques. There are several different types. Some of it I have included on the slide. So it is very important to stick to the size and time scale, because they govern the type of simulation to be employed. Because the equations and the theories that govern these techniques, they take into account the size and the time scale. So if you are studying a real world model, which is in the size scale of picometers or picoseconds, then quantum simulations would be an appropriate technique. If you are studying atomic scale like Armstrong or nanometer size scale and the time scale of nanoseconds, then atomistic simulation would be an appropriate type. So these are mainly applied for drug discovery, interaction of drugs with proteins, targets, etc. If you go further up the size scale, coming to formulations, which are usually in micrometer size range, you can have a different type of coarse grain simulation for it. And going beyond anything above centimeters, meters, and even beyond that, you can have continuum simulations, which are applied for large processes wherein bulk motion is involved, like bulk motion of fluids, tablets in a coater, etc. So the most widely explored till now in drug discovery, at least, or formulation or processes, is the atomistic coarse grained and the continuum simulation. I would be taking up examples later on based on the first two, that is atomistic and coarse grained simulation. Just to extend the previous slide further, the applications of these techniques in drug delivery, the quantum simulation, as I said, it applies to picometer or picosecond size range. So it can be well used for small molecules or to gauge interactions of electrons or transitions of electrons and so on. The atomistic scale simulations, they are much widely known because it is much widely explored in drug discovery. So you can have drug excipient interactions, interactions between two different drugs, interactions between drug and the proteins and so on. Going higher, you can have the coarse grain simulations for studying nano drug delivery systems in the size range of maybe nanometers or micrometers, like microspheres. The most widely studied is the liposome. Liposomes have been studied, how the membrane is fluid, how it can interact with other membranes or biomembranes like skin. All of this has been studied using coarse grain simulation. And anything beyond that, like medical devices or macro scaled drug delivery systems like tablets, capsules, dissolution process, the process of compression, coating, all of it which involves bulk motion, all of it can be studied by continuum simulation. So if you take a close look at this slide, you will realize that all of it relates to pharmaceutical product development and simulation in some or the other form. All of these computational tools or techniques that we have been talking about can be applied in one or the other way to any of the stages of the pharmaceutical product development. So now coming to a brief about the protocol of a computer simulation. We have already seen what a simulation is. I've already defined it here. To explain it in simplest of terms, although it is not so simple, I have oversimplified it in just three steps: the input, the computation, and the output. The input is in terms of the models that we have been talking about. I talked about a computer model in the previous slide. So it would be the descriptors that would describe how that model is, or what that model is, what is the property of that model. If it is a 3D structure of a molecule, then what are the what is the molecular weight, log p, valency, dipole, and so on. Then you would need a program to run the simulation. So once you have the model, you will have to run it or simulate it to match the or imitate the real world system. So you would need a program. And this is important to discuss because we as, or perhaps I as a pharmaceutical professional, I do not have a background in computers. I do not have a background in programming. So when it comes to softwares, there are again two types of it. One is open source, which is free to use, but the limitation is that it is based on scripts or codes that you have to type in and get the outcome. So we do not really have a background to it. So what we have to rely on is some proprietary commercially available softwares which have an interface, just like you have an interface for PowerPoint or Word. It also has an interface. You just click a button and the command is executed. But a limitation to it is that it is not freely available. So perhaps as an individual, I may not be able to afford it, but as an institution, as a department, or as an industry, you can certainly can. And finally, the result of the input after computation results in some outputs in terms of some images which look very attractive, which look very beautiful, but they are usually useless if not supported by statistics or some numerical values, some mathematics, some plots or charts. And in fact, all of these simulations is useless if you do not validate it by appropriate in vitro or in vivo techniques. You have to prove that indeed the simulations, they are actually what it is in the real time. So validation is also an important aspect of these techniques or using these techniques. So now the question is, having a background to simulation, now we come to the main question, that whether simulations or these techniques, can it be used as a screening tool? Now, it is not again something new. Like I've been saying, simulations have been used for quite some decades in drug discovery. So we have something called the virtual high throughput screening, wherein we screen thousands or even lakhs of molecules against a particular target or a protein. And based on a score, we then select the best few and take it forward into the next stage of development. But the real question now is whether the same thing can be extended to formulation or formulation development or drug delivery. Now, this is something new. It has started in research. At least you will come across several works which have started upon working liposomes or micelles using these computational techniques, studying some aspects relating to drug release, drug loading of liposomes and micelles, how they would interact with the surrounding media, etc. What I would be demonstrating at the end would be something applicable to a new form of drug delivery system called nanostructured lipid carriers. It is type of a nano carrier system called nanostructured lipid carriers. So now coming to one brief slide about why to learn these techniques. This perhaps would be targeted to the audience who are students, who are still in their bachelor or master's course, who still have a lot of time to learn these techniques. So why is it important to learn these techniques? I would like to draw analogy to the concept of QBD. Which is used for development of a drug product in industries, particularly ANDA products, which are to be marketed in the US. It has to have approval with the FDA. So the FDA, it made the concept of QBD mandatory after some time in 2012. And one of the important aspects of QBD, that is quality by design, is developing a pharmaceutical product by employing the concept of design of experiments. Now this technique, it involves or utilizes a set of certain softwares. So suddenly after this time period, the need for professionals knowing the knowledge of DOE increased tremendously. Even need for professionals who knew the knowledge of these softwares grew tremendously. Even the demand for these softwares which are there for DOE grew tremendously. So perhaps the same thing is going to happen to these other computational techniques that you have seen in the last 5 days. There are hints already from FDA. You can see in September 2016, FDA came with a guidance document for the industry, wherein they laid down guidance for reporting of computational modeling studies for medical devices. So they have not entirely accepted at least computational studies, but at least they are acknowledging it. If 2016 is not recent enough, there is another guidance which was released in 2018 for PBPK modeling. So I think some of the speaker has already covered this topic, which is also based on computer modeling or simulation. So there are signs that FDA is already acknowledging the use of these techniques as a supporting study along with in vivo study. In fact, you can go through the FDA website yourself and you can try punching all the keywords that you have gathered along these 5 days, like computational, computer assisted, computer based, simulation, and you can see the results that come on the website. You will be surprised to see so many links that will maybe indicating that FDA is slowly moving towards computation-based techniques. So it is very important for the students out there at least to learn these techniques when you have time now. Okay, so now with that small background, we have covered what is simulation or what these techniques are, where it can be applied, how it is to be applied. Now we take up some examples of these in some real world systems. Can I proceed? I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this particular example, the first one, it relates to atomistic molecular dynamic simulation. If you recall, I showed you some four kinds of simulation. So atomistic molecular simulation is one of it. It applies to the size scale of Armstrong or nanometers, which generally these small molecules like ligands or drugs or proteins fall in. And the problem statement, it relates to mucoadhesion. Mucoadhesion is a phenomena wherein the formulation, it takes advantage of certain properties of mucin or mucus, and it can be retained in that particular area. So you can have mucoadhesion at the ocular site, at the nasal cavity, along the gastrointestinal tract, also around the buccal cavity, and so on. So can simulation be used in some or the other way to screen certain ligands which have propensity towards mucoadhesion, which can show mucoadhesion? Can it be used as a screening tool? So that is the problem statement. Can simulation help in understanding binding between ocular mucin? I would be taking up the example which relates to ocular mucoadhesion. So can it help me understand how ocular mucin, it interacts with some mucoadhesive ligands? And if yes, can it be used as a screening tool for screening certain mucoadhesive ligands? Just like we have screening for drug discovery, can it also be extended to mucoadhesion? So to understand the role of a particular mucin called MUC4 in ocular mucoadhesion, there are several types of mucin, ranging from MUC1 to MUC20 or even more. I'm not sure, but MUC4, it is predominantly present on the ocular surface. So you have the sclera, which is the white portion of the eye, the cornea, which is the clear portion of the eye, and the conjunctiva, which is the red membrane around the eye. The MUC4, it covers all of this surface. There are also some other extraneous mucin that are present in the tear film. So if I have to develop a formulation, a nano formulation, which I have to target and make it retain in the eye, then I would want it to interact or retain more on the MUC4, that is the mucin that is anchored on the surface of sclera, cornea, and conjunctiva, that is all over the eye. So I would like to have my formulation directed more towards this MUC4 than the tear film mucin. Why? Because tear film, it is always in constant motion. It is always been cleared by the defense mechanisms of the eye, which is blinking, the tear drainage, and other enzymatic degradation as well. So immediately, as the nanoparticles that are bound to the mucin in the tear film will be cleared off. So I would like to have my ligands bind more to MUC4 to have them retain more on the ocular surface. So to understand whether simulation can help in this process of screening certain mucoadhesive ligands towards ocular mucoadhesion, we will have to come back to the theories of mucoadhesion. So there are four basic theories of mucoadhesion: the adsorption theory, the electronic theory, the wetting theory, and the diffusion theory. What is important is the mechanism by which these occur. So the common or the less common are swelling, the rheological properties of the polymer, the spatial conformation of the material or the polymer. The more widely known are covalent binding and non-covalent binding, but covalent binding is not desired because it is irreversible. So we are left with non-covalent binding, the mechanisms for which are hydrogen bonding, ionic interaction, van der Waals forces, and hydrophobic interactions. So if you look closely at these are nothing but molecular properties. They come down to the molecular level. So if you recall in one previous slide, I had mentioned that when it comes to molecular properties, it can be well studied using computational techniques or some computational tools. So perhaps, yes, even mucoadhesion, since it is related to these molecular properties, it can maybe studied by in silico simulation. So can we screen mucoadhesive ligands towards mucoadhesion using such computational tools? That is to be seen. So firstly, to run the simulation, we would require the computer models of the system. So the system, it relates to mucoadhesion. So we would require the mucin and the different ligands, the mucoadhesive ligands. So the mucin that we are choosing is MUC4, just because I previously said it lines the entire ocular surface. So we would be using MUC4. So MUC4 is nothing but a large glycoprotein consisting of several amino acids. And what is important to note is that if you take the electrostatic map of this MUC4, you would notice that there are several regions that are associated with negatively charged amino acid residues that give it a net negative charge. Of course, there are positively charged amino acid residues as well, but the red region, that is the negatively charged amino acid residues, dominate over the positively charged. So overall net charge on a mucin molecule is net negative. So we would like to have mucoadhesive ligands which are positively charged so that they can interact with it by ionic interactions. So we chose certain ligands which have a net positive charge. So initially we only started off with three, I know this is a screening, so we would have a lot of we should have a lot of ligands, but since we were trying to prove a proof of concept and trying to do it for the first time, we started off with three known ligands which have a positive charge. And just to have a confidence that these technique or these computational tools are indeed working or they are indeed sensitive towards charge, we also took something which is negatively charged, that is glyceryl stearyl citrate. The citrate moiety, it gives them a negative charge. So with these ligands and the MuC4, we proceeded with the simulation. So now, just like I said, that you cannot simply apply any simulation technique to any kind of a real world problem. Similarly, within the simulation technique as well, you cannot do it in any way. You have a protocol to follow. So the protocol is in this way. Firstly, you will have to build the structures. You will have to verify the structure, note any discrepancies in the structure, note that the valence is right, all the structure is right, etc. Then you will have to apply or assign force fields, which usually the software does by itself, because all of these elements that are quite known, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, etc., they have certain electronic or other properties of their own. Then an important step is energy minimization. So simulation, you take all of these ingredients and you fill it in a box, an imaginary box. So when you fill it, all of these ingredients, there may be overlap between two or more atoms, two or more molecules, etc., which may impact your result. So the system, it should be at its minimum energy. So we have a step called energy minimization, and then comes the main step, that is molecular dynamics. That is, you run the simulation to simulate the real world system, how in real world it will interact with the MuC4. And at the end, you get some very nice images and videos, which are not quite useful unless supported by some statistics, some numbers, some graphs or plots. And that is the last step of it. So starting with the simulation, this is how the box looks. The simulation box, the one at the center is the MuC4, the protein, and the one at the left you can see is any one of the ligands, and it is also surrounded by some media. You can have water, you can have any of the biological fluids, you can have ions introduced, you can have any other solvent as well. Then you run the simulation at a particular time, at a particular temperature and pressure, and you make sure you have the right parameters to analyze. So since it relates to mucoadhesion, which will be simply a contact between the protein and the ligand, I am interested in that particular parameter, that is protein ligand contact, and the interaction fraction, that is meaning within the contact itself, which kind of contact it is, whether it is electrostatic interaction, whether it is hydrogen bonding, whether it is some other interaction, and so on. So after the simulation is complete, you get a trajectory, that is an estimation of where an atom or a molecule it would be at a particular time. So the computer or the software, it simulates for it, and it results in some images like these. So you can see it predicted for chitosan, one of the ligands, that it would be bound to the MuC4 throughout the simulation time. You can see the same is being depicted in the images. For stearylamine, that was another of the ligands, it is also seen to be bound to the MuC4 throughout the simulation time. However, that was not the case for CTAB, that was the third ligand that was used. You can see it is only intermittently binding with the MuC4 as compared to the other two. And now you will understand perhaps the reason for introducing extra ligand with a net negative charge. When we analyzed that, it was found that it hardly interacted with the MuC4, perhaps due to the negative charge. Just to show the same few images in the previous slide in a close-up to make you understand how the output is in terms of graphics, it not only shows the interaction, but it also shows the type of interactions that is occurring in terms of the colored dashes, like yellow for hydrogen bonding, purple for ionic interactions, blue for hydrophobic interactions, and so on. Now, what I showed you was only 5 of the thousands of images that was captured. So the simulation time, it, at a specific interval, it captures the frame. So if you stitch all of those 1,000 frames, you get a video out of it, which gives a very detailed information about the dynamics of the interaction. So you can actually see how it would occur in the real time. I'll just let it play. So this is how the frames look when stitched together, all the 1,000 frames. So you can see chitosan, it is bound to the ligand throughout the simulation time. Even stearylamine is bound. CTAB intermittently, it leaves the MUC4. And you can see the negatively charged glyceryl stearyl citrate, it hardly binds to the mucin. It also shows the dashes or the interactions that could be happening at any given frame. So like I said previously, although it shows some very, or it gives the output in terms of some very good images or videos, it is usually not so useful unless it is analyzed by some other numerical or statistical parameter. So to study the frames or the video in detail as to what exactly or how many protein ligand contacts are actually happening, you have within the software itself, some analysis. One is the timeline representation, that it shows the number of contacts that is happening between the ligands and the protein along the course of simulation. And the other is the interaction fraction, that is, it then streamlines the contacts, like which actual type of contact is happening, whether it is hydrogen bond or ionic bond or hydrophobic interaction or water bridges. So the first analysis, that is timeline representation, it can be depicted in two plots. The first one, it gives an idea about how many contacts are happening. So around 6 to 9 contacts you can see on an average happening at any given time along the simulation time. And the lower part of the plot, it tells you the extent of these contacts, like it is depicted by the shade of the orange. A lighter shade would mean that at any of these residues the contact is happening, and a lighter shade would indicate a single contact, while a darker shade would indicate a multiple contact or several contacts. So you can see for chitosan there are interactions occurring on several residues. The intensity of it is also very high, like several multiple contacts are occurring simultaneously as indicated by the dark orange shade. And also several contacts are occurring as high as 9 to 10. For stearylamine, although there are several residues involved in the contacts, but the extent of contact is pretty less. You can see the shade of orange is pretty light. And even here, you can see hardly 1 or 2 or maximum 4 contacts happening simultaneously. For CTAB, it is hardly anything. You can hardly see any stroke of orange here, and only 4 of the residues involved, and maximum of 2 simultaneous contacts. The other important analysis, now I know that contacts are indeed occurring, but which type? So for that, to answer that which, you have the interaction fraction, which decides or which depicts the exact type of contact that is occurring. So for chitosan oligosaccharide, when analyzed, it was found to have all the 4 contacts that can be detected by the software. The hydrogen bonds, the hydrophobic interactions, the ionic interactions, and as water bridges as well, which is a kind of a hydrogen bond. What is important to note here is the intensity of these interactions. Why? Because you will understand with the next figure. In stearylamine, it may appear that the contact is much better than chitosan because it is interacting with many other residues and even the bar is higher, but no, if you see at the scale, it is much lower than chitosan. And for CTAP, please don't be fooled by the size of these graphs. You can see it is hardly anything. By the scale, if you go by the scale, it is almost negligible. So what I have, or what we have found using simulation, is that yes, we can screen, at least with respect to the type of contacts or to the extent of contacts, we can screen mucoadhesive ligands in silico. Okay, but like I said, that is not enough. The validation is also an important step. So we proceeded with validating first the same outcome in vitro, whether it can be it is the same in vitro or not. So for that, we proceeded with in vitro mucoadhesion tests. But before that, we had to make nanoparticles out of it, because a single molecule, although I could do it in silico, it was very feasible to assess a single molecule of chitosan, sterolimine, or CTAB for mucoadhesion in silico. That cannot be done in vitro. So we had to prepare nanoparticles of these molecules and coat it with these mucoadhesive ligands, the chitosan, the sterolimine, and the CTAB separately. So I won't go into the details of the preparation of nanoparticles, because it is not relevant with the topic of this presentation. So coming to the mucoadhesive test, the in vitro test that we employed, there are several different types of mucoadhesion tests that you can employ for assessing mucoadhesion in vitro. The most widely used one is texture analyzer, which is a very good instrument. It has very wide applications as well, but it is more suitable for macro scale delivery systems like gels, suspensions, ointments, tablets, solutions, and such delivery systems. When it comes to the nano scale, it is entirely out of the scope of that instrument to assess mucoadhesion at the nano scale. So we went for something which is been recently used, like nanoparticle tracking. We tried the concept of nanoparticle tracking towards mucoadhesion. So what the concept, it exploits the Brownian motion of nanoparticles. So if you must be aware that nanoparticles, when suspended in a particular media, it has an inherent motion of its own. Like it is a random motion. It is referred to as the Brownian motion. So what is interesting about it is that the motion, it is also dictated by the kind of media that it is suspended in. So if it is not interacting with the media, it will be a different kind of diffusion. And if it is interacting with the surrounding media, it will be a different kind of the diffusion, the motion. So the instrument, it does nothing but that. It passes a very fine laser across these nanoparticles, which is suspended in a particular media, and it measures the diffusion coefficient. So based on the value of the diffusion coefficient, you can make some assessment regarding the media that the nanoparticles, they are suspended in. To explain it into even simpler terms, so if I have my surface modified nanoparticles, which has chitosan or sterolimine or any other mucoadhesive ligand at the surface, and I extend it or suspend it in water, then it will not interact with the water because it is inert. It does not have any dissolved materials. It does not have any mucus in it. It does not have any charge on it. So there will be no interaction. So the diffusion of such nanoparticles in water will be quite high. So which can be indirectly related to, say, less mucoadhesion. While on the other hand, if I replace the same media with, say, mucin, which has lot of, say, MUC4 type of proteins in it, then now these nanoparticles, they will interact with the media. They will interact by electrostatic interactions, hydrogen bonding, etc. And this will result in lowering of the diffusion or the movement of these nanoparticles, which can then be correlated with higher mucoadhesion. So this is all the concept is based on. So we proceeded with first taking the diffusion coefficient, measuring the diffusion coefficient by the instrument called nanoparticle tracker in water. So since it will not interact with it, you can see the division coefficient was pretty high, and it was nearly similar for all of it since there was no interaction. But as soon as we replaced the media with mucine solution, you can see the diffusion coefficient dropped significantly, and the extent of the drop or the extent of the reduction of the diffusion coefficient, it could directly be correlated with the interactions that could be happening between the media, which is mucine, MUC4, and the nanoparticles. So we could get the same outcome like we got in the in silico studies. That is a very good in vitro mucoadhesion for chitosan as compared to sterilamine, and hardly any for CTAP. Okay, so we now also assessed in vitro mucoadhesion in order to validate that what we found in silico can indeed happen in vitro as well. But we were not satisfied. We also then went ahead with in vivo mucoadhesion to assess in vivo mucoadhesion. In vivo mucoadhesion, it is not something new. It is a pretty straightforward process. You load a particular dye like coumarin in those nanoparticles, the same ones that I described previously. You administer it to a rat model or a rabbit model, whichever be the case. You excise the model eyes after a particular time, and you measure the fluorescence intensity. So this was the fluorescence intensity or the images that were observed for chitosan, sterilamine, and CTAP. So straight away you can make interpretation with respect to CTAP, but for COS and sterilamine, by looking at the images, it is not pretty clear. But when you convert those into the fluorescence intensity, it is pretty clear that it is higher for COS, that is chitosan, as compared to sterilamine, and much, much higher as compared to CTAP. So what this study briefly depicts is that what you can do in vivo in terms of mucoadhesion, or in vitro in terms of mucoadhesion, you can also do it in silico. That is, you can screen certain mucoadhesive ligands in silico as well. So this was an example of using the atomistic molecular dynamic simulation for something like sort of a screening or a pre-formulation study for mucoadhesive ligands towards mucoadhesion. In fact, you can extend this particular study or this particular technique, that is the atomistic MB, to other systems as well at the atomic scale, like excipient interaction, drug excipient interaction. If they are interacting, then what are the degradation products? What are the impurities? If they are degrading, then what is the stability of such compounds, and so on. You can also employ it to certain kind of macromolecules, particularly the delivery system called cyclodextrins, which forms a structure and a complex. It forms a complex structure with the drugs. You can study it well by using these techniques. And you can, of course, apply it to proteins, which have been done widely in drug discovery. So with that, I would like to move to the second example that I would be taking. And this is with respect to a different kind of simulation. So in the previous kind, we used atomistic molecular dynamic simulation to assess something which is at the atomic scale, that is a small molecule, or at the best a large macromolecule like protein. But when it goes beyond that, like a formulation like a nanoparticle, microsphere, etc., you will have to change the technique that you would be employing. So we have used the coarse-grained molecular dynamic simulation technique to see or assess how it can be employed in formulation development of a nano carrier, like nanostructured lipid carrier. It is a type of a nanoparticle. So the problem statement is that there are several steps involved in this formulation of this NLC, several ingredients that are involved in the formulation of these NLCs, and they have a very wide impact on the properties of the final product or the final NLC that is made. So can simulation or some of the techniques can be used to develop these formulation rationally, to study these formulation in detail and screen them or develop them rationally using some of these techniques. So firstly, coming to the brief of what NLC is, you can imagine it as an equivalent of an emulsion. An emulsion, you have a droplet of an oil extended or suspended in a media like a surfactant solution or a water. The same thing you can imagine or visualize with respect to a solid particle. So you have the precursor of NLC, which is the solid lipid nanoparticles. So unlike the oil droplet, which is suspended in the surfactant solution, you have the solid particle, which is suspended in the surfactant solution. And when you replace some fraction of the solid particle with oil, you have the nanostructured lipid carriers. The reason for adding this oil is to make this particle flexible, fluid, and accommodate more of drug. So it may sound very simple, but just this step of addition of a small quantity of oil, it results in a very difference in the structural properties of this particular nanoparticle. And that is why it is to be studied systematically. And this is where these computational techniques, they come in handy. So what exactly happens when you add some fraction of oil? If you see the structure of solid lipid, it is a very ordered crystalline structure. It is very rigid. It is not so flexible. So it doesn't accommodate much of drug. So when you add some fraction of oil, the ordered crystalline state, it becomes sort of disordered, and it becomes a bit a little fluid. It becomes flexible, and so it is able to accommodate higher quantities of drug. But the question is, how much of oil can you add? Because there is no consensus in the literature. If you see, go through the literature, some have added as less as 0.1%. Some have added as high as 60% of oil. Why this percent is important is because ultimately, based on the ratio of these lipids and oil, the different structures of NLCs are possible. You can have a core shell type of a structure wherein one of the phases is surrounded by the other. You can have a domain type of a structure wherein one of the phases is surrounded, embedded as domains in the other. Or you can have a matrix type of a structure. And why knowing which structure is formed is important is because based on these different types of structures, you can have differences in the physical, the chemical, and the in vitro performance of these NLCs. How it will interact with the biomembranes, how it will release the drug. All of it is dependent upon the type of structure that is formed and which is indirectly related to the percentage of oil. So it is very important to study this in detail. So the real world methods, they do not really allow for this because you cannot really see these ultra structures. Even with a high electron microscope, you cannot really see what is happening inside these NLCs, but you can build computer models of it and study it, simulate it on a computer and make assumptions that this must be happening. So it is very important to understand the effect of these individual components and rationally screen and select the best composition. So again, the problem statement is that whether simulation, it can help in gaining a mechanistic insight on how the percentage of oil or the percentage of lipid is affecting the internal structure of the NLC. And if yes, then can these internal structures, modeling these different internal structures, can it be done in silico and can it be studied on how it will affect its properties, say how it will release the NLC and so on. Before moving forward, I would like to explain the importance of coarse graining. So if you recall the previous example that I took, it was atomistic molecular dynamic simulation. It was something at an atomistic scale. why coarse graining is important when it comes to nano drug delivery systems or simulating nano drug delivery systems, I would like to take the example of a molecule called phosphatidylcholine. Okay, it is the major component of all the biomembranes and also of a delivery system called liposome, AmbiZome, that is amphotericin liposome, which is currently in use. The liposome, it is made up of these phospholipids, that is phosphatidylcholine. So if I have to make a 3D model of liposome, a nano drug delivery system, a 3D model of it, and if I use the atomistic model, then I will have to account for all the five elements that are there in this molecule: carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus. So there will be around 118 atoms itself in this one molecule. So if I have to build a 3D model of a liposome, one single liposome, there will be around 40, I think, lakh model atoms involved in it. If I consider the media, it will add to around 60 lakh atoms. So the computational time and the energy required to predict the outcome for such a high... Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Did you say something? I was not able to hear.
No, please continue, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. So I was saying that the amount of computation, energy and time required to analyze each and every of these high number of atoms will be tremendous. So that is why such techniques like atomistic models, they are very limited to drug discovery. That is studying small molecules, small drug molecules, at max some macromolecules like proteins. But when it comes to formulations, which are in the scale of nanometers or micrometers, you have to coarse grain it. That is, you have to assign a set of atoms to a particular bead. So you convert a phosphatidylcholine molecule, which has 118 atoms, into a coarse grain model, which will have only 10 beads. One bead will represent a group of certain atoms which are there in the atomistic model. So that reduces everything 10 times, at least for this example, it reduces everything by 10 times. So this can be easily managed using a decent computer. A decent computational time would be required to simulate these processes. So that is why coarse graining, it is very important when we are studying systems like nano drug delivery systems. So what coarse graining does basically is it overlooks atomic details which are not really required when you are studying formulations. Atomic details perhaps would be required when you are studying individual molecules. When I am studying a whole formulation, atomic details are not important. So it simplifies the model and it accelerates computation. So perhaps this, even if I try to do it, it will take months or even years to simulate. This can be done in a fraction of that time. So again, the same simulation protocol like we had for the previous example, the only difference is that additional step of assigning parameters. So if you recall, we have grouped certain atoms into certain beads. So those beads, they are chosen by us, the group of atoms, they are chosen by us. So there are no parameters describing them. So we'll have to first assign parameters to them and then proceed with the simulation. The rest of the steps remain the same. After the simulation, you'll have to analyze the outcome, the images, the frames in terms of certain figures, plots, statistics, and so on. So the first step is mapping a set of atoms into beads, that is coarse graining. So the oil phase, if you recall NLC, it is made up of oil and the solid lipid. So the oil phase, it was mapped to three different beads of equal, almost equal molecular masses. The glyceryl stearate, the solid lipid, it was a fairly larger molecule. So it was coarse grained into four beads, whereas the water molecule, it was represented as one bead. What is important to note is the nomenclature here, O describes the oil, L describes the solid lipid, W describes the water. It is important to then now moving to the images. So again, to find out these interaction parameters, the parameters that I've been talking about, they do not, the beads, they do not have it on their own. You have to assign it to them. So the software, it already has the mode to find these parameters. So again, you make a simulation box and run the simulation, and the parameters to find are mainly the solubility parameter, which is finally required to derive the interaction parameter, which is assigned to these individual beads. So that it tells the beads how to interact with the surrounding water and how to interact with the other beads as well. So how LA bead will interact with LB, with LC, with OA, OB, OC, and so on. Each of these, how it will interact with each other, that has to be assigned first. Then comes the building of the model. So since the problem statement, it deals with the different concentration of the solid lipid and the oil, we would like to build model based on them. So we tried to incorporate the whole spectrum of the oil and the solid lipid component, like starting from a low solid lipid, moving on to the higher content of solid lipid. So we could cover the whole spectrum of the concentration of oil and solid lipid. So the L, the nomenclature L is for the lipid, the 20 is for the 20%, moving on to 80%. O is for oil, 80 is for 80%, moving down to 20%. So these were how the models would look when you try to do it on that particular software, Material Studio. And if you wish to study these models further, to further characterize it in silico itself, to study how the models are at the surface, to study how the models are from within, you can do it by taking different views. So you can take a cross-sectional view of these models as well. The software, it provides for that as well. So this is how the first model it looked. Now you can immediately make out that it is in the form of a core shell based system. You have a shell of the oil and a core of the solid lipid. This is how the second model looked. It is also on the lines of a core shell type of a system, but the core or the shell, sorry, is quite different as compared to the first one. I cannot really make out what these two systems are just by looking from the images. So for that, you can have certain aid which are there in the software, like you can analyze them with respect to something called the concentration profile. It is just like HPLC. When HPLC detects an analyte, it creates a peak for it. Similarly, in the software, you have this module which you run on a model, and as soon as it detects a bead, it creates a peak for it. So for example, if I have a model which is made up of two beads A and B, and if I try and analyze it from the X axis, this is how the concentration profile for it would look. If I try to analyze it from the Z axis, this is how the concentration profile would look. And if I try to analyze it from the Y axis, this is how it would look. So it gives me an indication of the distribution of the different beads within the computer model, or the model that I have just shown you. So for the first model, the concentration profile, it looked something like this. You can see it, you can clearly make out right by looking at the image itself that it is a core shell type of a system. You have the shell, you have the core, and then again you have the shell. Shell, core, shell. The second one is, again, you can make it out from the image itself, but the shell is somewhat different. It is diffused, it is merging with the core, and the same was seen in the concentration profile as well. There is hardly any gap in between the core and the shell. And the third one is the one which I had difficulty with, that is, I could not make it out from the image what kind of system it is, but when I do a concentration profile of it, it becomes quite clear. So you can see it is a complete overlap of the two systems, that is the oil and the solid lipid. I'm not currently talking in terms of the drug because I've not included it in the presentation because it is not relevant to this NLC. NLC, you can understand it in terms of oil and solid lipid itself. So you can see it is a complete overlap, so that it is matching with the matrix system. It is more on the lines of a matrix system, the different structural NLCs that I showed you. And finally, the last one, you can see, or you can relate it with domains of one particular, which is oil, which is being created in a matrix of a solid system. And I have a statement that the solid lipid has a profound impact on the structural characteristics of the NLC. Why? Because if you see an overlay of all the images together, you will understand that as the concentration of the lipid is increasing, the solid lipid is increasing, it is leading to a difference in the structural property of the NLC. You can see from distinct boundaries, it is moving to overlapping boundaries. It is then moving on to complete overlap, then followed by small domains of the oil within the solid lipid. So you can study or characterize your models in the software itself by using such modules or analysis like concentration profile. So now I have, or I'm sure, or I'm confident that I have built different structural NLCs that are possible. One is of core shell type, one is of matrix type, and one is of domain type. Now I would like to see how it impacts, the disintegration of these NLCs, how they interact or how they perform in a media like water, how it will perform over time in a media which is water. Like you can see here, the NLC is suspended in a media which is water, which is represented by that one beam. So for that, you will have to run the simulation. This is how the simulation box would look on similar lines, the one that I showed for atomistic simulation. You can see the water beads, and in the center is the particular model. So it was run 4 times for the 4 different models. And the parameter that I would be interested in is in seeing how the different ratios, it impacts the fate of the NLC in water. So again, at the end of the simulation, it results in several images starting from the initial frame. This is how it would look. And over time, this is how it would interact, how the oil and the solid lipid, it will interact with each other and the media as well. And this is how it will disintegrate. Now I have hidden the water beads for visualization. If I show this with the water beads, it won't be visible. So I've hidden the water beads for the visualization purpose, and this is how it would look. And again, this is only some of the frames of the thousands that were captured. So if I stitch all those 1,000 frames together, again, it will result in a video which will give me a more better understanding of the dynamics of the NLC in a water media. So this is how it would look. So you can see as the component of solid lipid is increasing, it is constricting the maybe the spread of the different systems, the oil. So this is the video for it. If you cannot make it out clearly from the video, you can always have some analysis. Like I said previously, videos and the images, they look very well, they look very attractive, but they do not mean anything unless correlated with some values, some mathematical or statistical values. So there is an analysis called mean square displacement in the software itself. that tells you how the bead it is behaving in that particular media. So it analyzes the bead, each and every bead, starting from its initial position to its final position, and based on how it is moving around, it generates a plot for it. Then it is said that the particles, it is in a random diffusive motion, that is nothing extraordinary to note here. If it is moving away or deflecting upwards, then it is said to be drifting away. And if it is constrained, if it is moving or deflecting downwards, then the particles are said to be in a confined or in a constrained movement. And the slope of these lines also tell you something about the movements or how they are, like whether it is fast or slow. So you, based on this, if you are not able to gauge it from the video or the images, maybe you can apply these analyses and make interpretations regarding how the different systems, that is oil and the solid lipid, it is moving around when the NLC it is in the water media. So in short, MSD, it is an indicator of the dynamic stability of the system based on the mobility of the oil or the solid lipid in this case. So when we analyzed the MSD, that is for oil component, it was found that there was not significant difference in most of them, but the lowest was found for the system which had 60% of oil and 40% of 60% of solid lipid and 40% of oil, which corresponded to the matrix type of the system. And the same thing was observed for solid lipid as well. In fact, for solid lipid, the differences was quite significant as compared to the oil. So that is why I made a statement that solid lipid is the one that has a profound impact on the structural properties of the NLC. You can see there is a varied difference, but again, the one with 60% of solid lipid is showing a very constrained or confined release. So based on these, you can make interpretations on how the solid lipid or oil would impact a delivery system like NLC. You can also maybe then make interpretations regarding how it would affect the stability, how it would affect the interaction with the membranes, etc., based on such findings. And then you can rationally design or go ahead with a suitable ratio or content. Further, you can also extend these type of simulations to other systems to find out the drug loading, whether the drug loading it is optimum, whether it is leaking drug from a liposome, whether the entrapment efficiency, how much you can gain. You can also study the formation of nanoparticles and the fate of nanoparticles in different media, the stability of these nanoparticles, the one that I just showed you, and other such applications are also possible on similar lines using this type of simulation. So here I would like to conclude the two examples with some remarks that you can indeed use in silico methods for applications like screening, for techniques like formulation development, at least when it comes to nano formulation. You can also do it for other formulations like tablets, capsules and others. Maybe some other technique will be required because it is at a different scale, but you can definitely do so. The examples that I showed you related to nanoparticles, so you can definitely do screening and development of nanoparticles by using some of these techniques. But it also has a limitation to it that we should acknowledge, and maybe that is to be studied further. The one in the previous example that I showed you, that is the atomistic simulation, it did not account for other physiological or external factors like blinking, like drainage, peer drainage. I could not account for it in the simulation. So I really do not know how much it will actually perform in the real time. And the other limitation for such in silico techniques is that there is no limit to what you can perform in a computer or on a computer. But when it comes to validating these by using some real-time instruments, it becomes very, very difficult. So even if you have some very robust or very a breakthrough finding in the in silico or on a computer, it will at times be very, very difficult to prove it by in vitro or in vivo techniques. So we have a long way to go before these techniques are actually brought into practice. So currently, if you see most of the application of these in silico techniques, they are towards supporting studies. So you support your in vitro and in vivo finding by using in silico techniques. But yes, of course, we are moving towards a point wherein we would only require in silico studies. So perhaps many of you might take up these studies and we will soon reach that point faster. So if you want to further explore the one study that I previously showed you, it is already published. You can access it. The other one is still under work. That is why I did not go into the details of it, the drug of it, etc. But I can certainly help you anytime with any of these studies or explanation if required beyond this training program as well. Before I conclude, I would like to thank certain individuals like Professor Vabia, who has given me free hand to work on the topics in my PhD, like these varied topics. Another individual, Dr. Jasmine Monpara, who actually introduced me to these concepts. I hope I am introducing some of you to these concepts for you to take them forward. And there are several other individuals from several different organizations who have helped me with these studies as well. So with that, I would like to thank everyone for your patient listening and the committee for allowing me to or giving me the opportunity to present this work. I have my email ID here. If you have any queries even beyond this training program, you're free to contact me. I'm open to help you with any of these studies if required.
Yes, sir. Very nicely deliberated, and the slides are very well organized, actually.
Thank you, ma'am.
Very, very impressed with your presentation, actually. And it was very new for us, especially the use of MD simulations in the screening of the excipients for the drug development. It will be a very well useful topic for the faculty members too, so that they can also do something new in that area in the coming days.
Yes.
And faculty members are requested to post the queries in the chat box. Or you can also unmute your mic and get clarifications from sir.
Okay, someone is asking for my email address.
Yes, sir.
Have it in the chat box. For some reason, my ACT key is not working.
Okay.
So please. So it's rohan.pai@nmims.edu. And my personal email ID is rohanvpai@gmail.com. At apostrophe is ACT.
Is it correct, sir? At least check once.
Yes,
I have posted.
Yes, ma'am, that's right. Thank you.
Yeah. And can you share something about the software, what you have used for this MD simulation, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Like I said, I do not have a background in these techniques, so I do not or I cannot use open source software. I do not know how to use them, so I have to rely on some commercial software. So the software that I used for the first study, the atomistic simulation, it is the Maestro by Schrodinger. And the other one, the second example that I showed you, it is Material Studio by Biovia. So both are commercial software. They are available at a cost. I think an institution can certainly afford it, not an individual.
Yes, sir. I hope there is no questions actually, and faculty members, you are very free to contact with sir at any time, and he'll be, I'm sure that he'll be in access with all of you through mail.
Yes, sure. I will be happy to answer any queries. I am open to collaboration as well, if anyone wishes. Sure,
yes, sir.
Sir,
personally me. I just really want to start some sort of really in MD simulations. So if at all I found any difficulty,
sure, ma'am. Certainly.
Kindly help me.
Certainly. If you don't have any questions, you can even post it on the mail. I would be happy to answer them if you have any questions later on as well.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. And one short note, I just want to tell on this moment actually, when I thought of searching for speakers, and I contacted Bhavya sir, and sir, I thought of requesting sir to give the presentation actually. But when I'm discussing with sir, sir said that more than me, my student will do the best. And I was surprised actually when some guru is telling like that, like Rohan will do the best more than me, and you can take the expertise of Rohan in this area. And okay, I said, okay, sir, no problem. If you are telling, definitely I'll follow. And I put a word to Bhavya sir, and I just contacted you. As sir said, you truly made it the best today.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm always grateful to sir. He has always encouraged me and has shown a lot of confidence in me. I hope I've done justice to the topic.
Yes, yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfect. Because I have a lot of confidence on Bhavya sir. And sir said that you are the best for that.
And, thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
You proved it again on this presentation. So I take this opportunity to present your certificate of appreciation from our management and the principal side, sir. So kindly accept it virtually, and here is yours. And the hard copy of the same will be posted to you in the mid of June, sir.
Once thank you, ma'am. Thank
all
you.
This moment will be once again back.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you for like joining on this day.
Yes, I would like to thank again every member of the committee for giving me this opportunity. I would also like to mention that this is my first talk as a resource person, and it happens to be on your platform. So I'm glad.
Very nice, sir. Very nice to have an expert speaker with Sound Hills College of Pharmacy as a first one in your professional
thank
career.
You. Thank you so much.
Nice. Very nice. And expecting your sessions in future too, sir.
Sure, ma'am. Certainly.
Yeah. So this is the first time we have connected, and I hope so it will navigate for further days too.
Yes, ma'am. Definitely.
Thank you so much, sir. Stay safe and take care of yours.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.